together, and what have you got? Bibbidi bobbidi boo. Solicatula, bitchikaboo, and bibbidi bobbidi boo. It'll do magic, believe it or not. Bibbidi bobbidi boo. Solicatula means bitchikaboo, but the thing in my bob that does the job is bibbidi bobbidi, bibbidi bobbidi, bibbidi bobbidi boo. Believe it or not, bibbidi-bobbidi, 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 boo. And in the morning, I feel like I'm
afraid to speak when I was just a lad. Me father gave me nose a tweak and told me I was bad. But then one day I slipped, learned a word that sent me aching, you know. The biggest word you ever heard, and this is how it goes.
Oh, supercalifragilisticexpialidocious. Even though the sound of it is something quite atrocious, if you say it loud enough, you'll always sound precocious.
I did want to mention that we're missing Morgan Russell, and we are so happy that she's out of the hospital and on the road to recovery. We hope, I don't know if she was up here for a few minutes, I don't know if she's still here, but Morgan, we're glad that you're healthy, and or getting healthy, and we did miss her tonight.
Thank you. cried a tear, you I did try. I was confused, you cleared my mind. I sold my soul, you bought it back for me, and held me up, and you gave me dignity. Somehow you needed me, you gave me strength to stand alone again, to face the world out on my own again. You put me high upon a pedestal, so high that I could almost see eternity. You needed me. You needed me. And I can't believe it's you. I can't believe it's true. I needed you, and you were there. And I'll never leave. Why should I leave? I'd be a fool. 'Cause I finally found someone who really cares. You held my hand when it was cold, when I was lost, you took me home. You gave me hope when I was at the end, and turned my eyes back into truth again. Stand alone again, face the world out on my own again. You put me high upon a pedestal, so high that I could almost see eternity.
temporarily kidnapped your teachers to bring you the following public service announcement.
Over the next several minutes, you will see a series of tips and tricks that will guide you to your upcoming four-year nightmare.
So please listen closely, Bubba.
Change your life!
And so we give you, for the first and last time,
How to Succeed in High School Without Trying,
by Jonathan Brandt. Lesson one.
Attendance.
If you miss too many days, it could mean trouble. Which is why we recommend a simple workaround.
And that is, legally change your name to what?
Here's how it works. Now that your name is what, if you can't make it to roll call, no problem. Your trap has already been set.
Felicia Walker.
Present.
Robert Walters.
Present.
Erica Weinstein.
Present.
What?
Present.
James Wilkins.
Present.
And just like that, without breaking a sweat, you have yourself a devoted and completely unaware accomplice. Thanks, Erica Weinstein. What?
Other than what, there are a wide variety of other names to choose from, such as, huh, and sorry,
be sure to proceed with. These names may cause confusion, ramifications later in life.
Not a lot of emergency response.
I'm sorry, my wife's having a baby.
Okay, stay calm, sir. What is your wife's name?
Exactly.
Sorry?
Uh-huh.
Who's having a baby?
My wife.
What is your wife's name?
Yes.
What?
Uh-huh.
I'm sorry.
You're sorry too?
This is confusing.
You're saying we're both sorry.
What?
Wait, are you what or sorry?
Sir, what is the emergency?
Yes, what is the emergency?
I'm sorry.
No, I'm sorry.
Where are you sorry?
I've been sorry since high school.
And sorry. That's awesome. I pulled the exact same trick in high school.
No kidding. What's your name?
Say that again.
What's your name?
Say that again.
What's your name?
Say that again.
I'm having a baby!
Yeah, we can get an ambulance.
Sure.
Lesson two.
English.
There's only one rule in English class, and that is,
no matter what you say,
say it with 100% confidence. You don't even have to understand what you're saying.
Here's some examples of what to say regardless of the literature being discussed.
Whenever any of the following themes are mentioned.
Darkness.
Black.
Albatross. Just raise your hand and sing.
That's a metaphor for death.
Also, no matter what literature is being analyzed, if there's a mother in it, mention Freud.
And no matter who the protagonist is, claim they're a Christ figure.
Other surefire methods include
stroking your chin.
Stroking your chin. Well, naughty.
And whenever possible, use the word
juxtaposition.
For example,
it's positively Freudian how the novel's Christ-like protagonist is juxtaposed with that albatross of death.
Yeah. We're also aware that many English teachers may require you to recite literature aloud in class.
Whether it's Wordsworth or Shakespeare.
No matter what you say.
Say it with 100% confidence.
If you're unprepared or don't understand the material, it makes no difference. As long as you say the words with
mysterious intensity.
Bonus tip, add random pauses and punctuation. It will make you seem like you know more than you actually do.
Take off the crust.
Two roads diverge in a yellow wood, and I could not travel, and be one traveler long. I stood and looked down to where I bent in the undergrowth, the undergrowth! This same method can be used with anything ever written, so feel free to practice at home with a more familiar material.
Now that it is raining more than ever,
know that we still have each other.
You can stand under my umbrella.
You can stand under my umbrella.
Ella.
Ella. Lesson three.
Math.
Math is hard.
Way hard.
Step one, identify a math partner.
This partner must be, without a doubt, the best at math in your class.
You're looking for a very specific breed of student.
Allow us to demonstrate. Say, you're a girl.
I'm a girl.
Really? Wow. And you're looking for the smartest male mathlete in your class. First, you must carefully scrutinize the competition. Subject A.
Don't be higher than average. like the means that a disproportionate amount of his spare time is spent in the weight room. And as the saying goes,
if he's wailing on his pecs, he ain't solving for X.
Physique test fail. Subject B.
Subject's 5 o'clock shadow and barbed wire tattoos clearly indicate subject is well into his 20s.
This also indicates the subject has likely taken basic algebra for the third or fourth consecutive year.
Fifth.
Age test failed. Subject C. Below average physique.
Faint odor of generic brand body soap. Attempt at matching yellow and purple.
Suitable age range as evidenced by the Dora the Explorer lunchbox. Said lunchbox can indicate even younger age, implying at least one skipped grade, ladies and gentlemen.
Jackpot! Ding, ding, ding!
Step two, use complex strategic maneuvering to arrange a social interaction. Wanna go out?
Yeah.
Step two. Say you're at a Halloween party.
Check out the cosign on this chicken tender.
So, what are you supposed to be?
An imaginary number, obviously.
I'm a vampire.
That guy thinks he's the square root of cool.
Math-tastic! High square root of 25!
And in no time at all, and with zero effort, you have unconsciously become a math expert.
Step four.
And this is very important.
Love each other forever.
Unlike in the movies where the girl uses the math to succeed, only to then dump him and run off with the quarterback. This is real life.
And in real life, even though Al's boy may seem a little out of touch and socially inept, it's only temporary.
And in 10 years, while the cool kids have long since lost their cool, Mathman grows up to be the most driven, most centered, and least awful guy you'll meet.
So in 10 years, would you rather have landed the starting quarterback?
Give me a beer.
You do the math.
Lesson four.
Foreign languages.
Now, due to time limitations, we can't cover all foreign languages. So we must draw one at random from this book.
And today's language will be
French. It is. Now, regardless of the foreign language you are taking, the recipe for success is the same. And that is,
if you're ever in a tough spot where you don't know what to say,
just rattle off random words anybody would know.
To illustrate, here's a student's class presentation of Parisian travel.
Bonjour, presentation. Voilà, France, Paris, Toupet,
Trump,
Lanzarote.
Merci beaucoup, encore, encore.
It's that simple.
And in the rare event that your teacher doesn't buy it, you'll be ready.
Bonjour, your presentation was a disaster. All you did was rattle off random words anyone would know.
Touché. Lesson 5. Science. Some teachers use what is called mnemonics to help students memorize scientific concepts.
Mnemonics are common phrases that jog the memory. For example, to memorize the taxonomic classifications of
kingdom, phylum, class, order, genus, species.
Just remember,
King Phil came over from Great Spain.
An expression that regularly comes up in everyday conversation.
Hey, Carla, what's up?
King Philip came over from Great Spain.
Cool.
We found that current mnemonics are old-fashioned and thus no longer effective.
So for easier memorization, let us recommend new and improved versions.
For example, to remember the kingdoms of
Monera, Cortesa, Fungi, Plant, Animal.
Just
my pants feel real awesome.
Or to remember the 40 mega components.
Wanting, adding, finding, sizing.
Just think.
Go away, Tom Cruise!
It's that simple.
Lesson 6. History. What's the hardest part about studying for a history test?
The dates.
And we don't mean the dates that this creepy guy doesn't go on.
We're talking about moments in history.
And there are quite a few moments in history to remember.
How many wars and revolutions and treaties have there been?
A lot.
At least four.
Yeah.
What you're about to see is an actual example from a real American history exam. When was the Battle of Appomattox?
A. 1861.
B. 1863. Or C. 1865.
Hard to know the answer when there are hundreds of other breaks. Hundreds of other dates floating around your brain, which is why we've come up with an easier way to study.
Notice the common thread among all the dates.
That's it.
That's right, they all start with 186.
And odds are, the final number is different for each option.
Which means when you're studying, you only have to memorize two words. Appomattox and five.
By cutting out 75% of your work a 1 hour study session now lasts 15 minutes.
Declaration.
Six.
Watergate.
Three.
Moon.
It's that simple.
One digit is all you need.
A word of caution. This special method may cause confusion elsewhere in life.
Congratulations, class of 7. Feels like only yesterday we were freshmen back in 3. And the Red Sox are 4 world champions.
I don't know about you, but I'm feeling
2.
Lesson 7.
P.E.
For some people, forced physical exertion is a welcome activity.
But not for normal people.
Which is why we've come up with a way to completely eliminate all sports from your high school day.
And that is...
Let your voice be heard!
We are sick and tired of the violence, of the barbarism, of the inhumanity.
Yeah!
Bone-crushing sporting events are deteriorating our bodies. And our soul.
Yeah, yeah!
Just look at what happened to Timmy Johnson's finger!
It hurts a little. Oh.
No more touchdown baskets. We will no longer stand idly by in your peace-loving learning sanctuaries while high-impact death-a-thons are thrust upon us! Especially, and I mean especially, when it's muggy outside.
And when the school board eventually vents your protest.
And they will.
Don't let them deceive you by merely switching volleyball to badminton or tennis to ping pong.
Such replacements still require you to move your legs.
You must not quit until you've won the race.
And we mean the figure of race, so your race requires legs.
What do we want?
Low impact activities that barely resemble actual sports.
When do we want it?
Third period.
And once the people have spoken, P.E. will never be the same.
And this concludes our final lesson.
We'll hope you apply what you've learned today so that you pass high school with flying colors.
And if you fail, I'm sorry.
No, I'm sorry.
This has been
How to Succeed in High School.
Without really trying.
You're welcome.
Melody, beautiful mess we are, honest cries of breaking hearts. gospel for the fallen ones locked away in permanent slumber, assembling their philosophies from pieces of broken memories. Oh, 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 oh. Gnashing teeth and criminal tongues conspire against the odds, but they haven't seen the best of us yet. If you love me, let me go. If you love me, let me go. Cause these words are knives and often leave scars. The fear of falling apart. Truth be told, I never was yours. The fear of falling apart. This is gospel for the vagabonds, not dwells in insufferable people. Confessing their apostasies, led away by imperfect imposters. Oh, oh, oh. Oh, oh, oh. Don't try to sleep through the end of the world and bury me alive, cause I won't give up without a fight.
If you love me, let me go. If you love me, let me go.
In the beginning, there was
chaos.
And everything was
void.
God saw all the emptiness and said, let there be light.
Then he got down to divide. On day one, he divided dark from light.
On day two, he divided the earth and the sea. And he divided water and firmament. He called this firmament heaven.
On day three, he divided day and night.
On Wednesday, he made vegetables.
On Thursday, celestial light. And on Friday, he made poultry and fish.
On Saturday, he partied all night and created the animals that roamed the earth.
In his own image, he made man.
And God said,
be fruitful and multiply and replenish the earth. Have dominion over the fish in the sea and the fowl in the air and every living thing that moves. I give you the power to reason and to think and to act.
I give you commerce, imperialism, industrial revolution. I give you morphine and penicillin and marijuana. I give you suburbia and shopping malls and overpopulation and ozone depletion and Madonna.
Ugh. And finally, on the seventh day,
God rested.
It was H.G. Wells who said, a history of humans is, in essence, a history of ideas.
I failed history.
And I don't know who H.G. Wells is.
The Bible is comprised of 39 books in the Old Testament and 27 books in the New Testament, which is the largest collection of books ever accepted as fact.
And so we give you the Bible, the complete Word of God, abridged.
By Adam Long, Reed Martin, and Austin Dishner. Good afternoon, I'm John Bossett.
And I am Tegan Meek, and today we will be taking you on a marvelous spiritual journey.
A marvelous spiritual journey.
Call it a mission.
A mission.
A pressing
a course, if you will.
John, go get the
book. John, this sucks.
We will present to you in its entirety the Bible, the greatest story ever accepted as fact.
We will shine a light on its mysteries.
Make the unknown known.
Make the inexplicable palatable.
But although this is the Bible, it is not alluding to a certain religion.
You're not trying to repress Christians or Jews or Muslims.
Or Buddhists or Hindus or Transcendentalists.
Or any cult member of any kind.
So, by a show of hands, who all has read the Bible cover to cover?
They're all a bunch of pagans.
Yes, we have our work cut out for us. Let us start in Genesis. And the Lord God created Adam.
My name is Adam, and I was made from a pile of dust.
Excuse me.
What?
Excuse me.
Who's there?
Excuse me. So the downfall of man begins. I love you.
But life can get kind of lonely when you're one and only.
Is the only other one.
And Eve conceived before our son Cain, and then she conceived again and bore his brother Abel.
And we all know what happens after that. Cain took Abel into the field where he hit him on the head with a rock.
We now move ahead to Abraham talking to God Almighty.
But wait, what about the Tower of Babel or Noah's Ark?
Everybody knows the story of the Ark.
But there are a lot of unanswered questions about the Ark, like were there dinosaurs on the Ark?
Yes.
But they weren't mentioned in the Bible.
No. A lot of things aren't mentioned in the Bible. Handguns, telephones, computers.
Wait, there were computers on Noah's Ark?
No, don't be stupid. Computers from the Garden of Eden.
How?
Eve had an apple, didn't she?
Yes.
Abraham, God, please. Thank you, Lord, for delivering me into the land of Canaan.
You're welcome. Now what will you give me to ensure that you and your male descendants will live in Canaan forever?
Anything, Lord.
I want you and your male descendants to be circumcised.
Oh, what?
It's an easy process. And if you do it when the children are babies, it won't hurt as much.
Gee, I'm glad you're looking out for my children.
Speaking of children, I'd like to talk to you about Isaac.
What about him?
I'd like you to kill him.
Excuse me?
Place upon him a burnt offering and sacrifice his life to me.
Isn't this a little pagan for a supposedly monotheistic religion?
Pagan schmagan. Do you live in fear of me or not?
Yes, Lord. I will sacrifice Isaac to you. Oh, Isaac. Daddy built you a new bed for you to sleep on, Isaac. He even has a built-in nightlight.
What are you doing?
I'm sacrificing my son to you, Lord.
I was kidding. Why do you fundamentalists have no sense of humor?
We now move ahead to Exodus, where Moses has just received the 10 commandments.
All right, children of Israel, listen up. I've got some good news and some bad news. The good news is, I got him down to 10. The bad news is, adultery is still one of them.
Oh.
But the other 10 commandments that I talked God out of cannot go without an honorable mention. I give you the top 10 rejected commandments. Take note. Number 10, thou shalt not pee in the swimming pool. 80s fashions was ugly then, and it's still ugly now. Number 8, thou shalt let the poor fend for themselves. Oh, wait, that's the Trump administration's objective. Number 7, thou shalt not lie. Frozen was really overrated. Number 6, the Christian right is neither Christian nor right. Number 5, thou shalt not find a parking place in Urbana. Number 4, thou shalt not flip thy bottles. Number 3, thou shalt not blame the entertainment industry for promoting violence or will shoot you in the head. Number two, crap happens. And the number one most objective commandment is, thou shalt not whip, nay, nay, or that.
There's great rejoicing and even more rules that down Leviticus numbers, but then in Moses' 120th year, he died peacefully, of course.
And so God appointed Joshua to become the new leader of Israel.
All right, Manton Hunt! We're moving into Canaan in over 600 hours. We're gonna hit the walls of Jericho and we're gonna hit them hard. Our objective, take back the land that our Lord God, the Supreme Commander, has given us. Ready, man? Sound off!
What?
That's enough. Ready? Gather around, it's time to go!
Gather around, it's time to go!
Kick some butt in Jericho!
Kick some butt in Jericho!
Now, I know the Old Testament is a real joyride, but we're only in Joshua, and there's still 25 more books in the Old Testament. We haven't even made it to the New Testament.
All right, folks, we're going to have to speed things up a little bit.
So in short, Daniel gets thrown to the lion's den.
He's going to Detroit.
And he was told to get thrown into a fiery furnace. Lot's wife gets turned into a pillar of salt. Jonah gets swallowed by a whale.
God slays the Ammonites.
The story of Samson and Delilah.
David and Goliath.
Here's some other boring stories. Now, da 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 da! The New Testament!
The birth of Jesus Christ!
Oh my gosh, I can't believe Mary's pregnant. We haven't even known each other yet.
Joseph, it's time!
You're so talented. How hard are you trying to
get? Joseph, it's coming!
Just remember the ring! Hit, hit, hoo, hoo, hit! Jesus hates Christ. The Holy Family then fled to Egypt to escape the wrath of Herod. At age 12, Jesus gets lost in a temple. And then there's this weird 18-year age gap and life Jesus. But then he suddenly reappears at the Jordan River to be baptized by John the Baptist.
I am here to prepare ye for the way of the Lord. Can I get an amen?
We'll
work on that later.
Oh, John, my pal, even though I've never met before.
I preach that one mighty and then me would come, but I am not yet worthy enough to stoop down and unloose your shoes.
I have no idea what you just said. But I assume you're talking about me.
I am talking about you. Will you be cleansed by my holy waters?
That is kind of why I'm here.
I baptize you in the name of the Father, and of you, and of the Holy Spirit. The Last Supper.
You're probably wondering why I've all called you here tonight. It may come as a shock to most of you, but tonight, one of you will betray me.
Is it I, Lord?
No, John, you're my beloved.
Is it me, Lord?
No, Mark, not you.
Is it I, Lord?
No, not you, Matthew.
Is it me, Lord?
Is it me, Lord? Is it me, Lord? What do you think, Judas?
I think you're overreacting!
I have many things to tell you all before we go. Simon, I will be named Peter, meaning the rock. St. Stephen, you'll become the first Christian martyr. Sorry. St. Bernard, you'll become a large dog that saves skiers in the Alps. St. Louis, you'll become a city on the Missouri River. And finally, St. Thomas, who become a resort of the Caribbean. Now, let us break bread.
Now, after they broke bread, Jesus was taken to Pilate, who later convicted him and sent him to be crucified.
No.
The soldiers then placed a crown of thorns on him. And then they crucified him, and a great darkness fell over the land. In the ninth hour, Jesus cried out,
Father, into thy hands I commend my spirit.
Then he died. And the soldiers placed him in a tomb. And now comes the greatest miracle of the entire New Testament, the resurrection. Clear.
Jesus then ascended into heaven, and that brings us to the final book of the Bible.
Wait! We skipped the entire New Testament.
The only other thing that really matters in the New Testament are the letters, and they pretty much just say three things. Love the Lord thy God, love thy neighbor as thyself, and it says, women, you're responsible for the downfall of man. So shut up and listen to your husbands. Revelation
pretty much just says, Armageddon is going to come, Satan is waiting, blah, 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 666, but in the end, Jesus will come back and resurrect all the dead.
So we'd say the Bible is a pretty swell.
We hope we did it well.
Or we may end up in hell.
Yeah. So that's it, the complete work of God.
As you can guess, we're both rather odd.
So you'd all better go.
Yeah, that's the end of the show.
Amen.
Good evening, everyone. Okay, so just to clarify real quick, in the programs it says I'll be singing 7 years by Lucas Graham, but I'm going to be doing what they call a rewrite cover to it. So in the song, he talks about his life. So I thought, well, it would be better if I talked about my life in a little bit. So I rewrote the lyrics, and so I hope you guys like it.
Could ever be. Once I was 7 years old. This is a big, big world, but I don't let that faze me. I put my brave face on from morning to the evening. By 11, I learned words that will never hurt me. Put on a smile so big just to make a steady figure. Once I was 11 years old, my daddy told me my heart was one of the best things about me. Once I was 11 years old. I've always had a big smile and I'ma keep on smiling. And in a town so small, I've always just kept believing. I've always kept on thinking, always kept on dreaming. Despite the sticks and stones, I will not be defeated. Now I'm 16 years old and my sister tells me she's always here to talk about my feelings. Now I'm 16 years old. I wanna make a change, make this a better place. We need to be in a place where everybody feels the same. I don't want anyone to feel alone or left out. Crying cause they don't fit in or nasty words I'll say to them. Soon I'll be 18 years old and my friends have told me to keep my chin up when I am struggling. Soon I'll be 18 years old. Soon I'll be 30 years old. What will our lives hold? Will I be satisfied with all that surrounds me? Soon I'll be 30 years old. No matter how old we are, age is just a number. It's never too late to change your life for the better, to finish the race or just to start another. Life's another mystery waiting to be discovered. Soon I'll be 60 years old, hoping, am I proud of what I have become over the years? Soon I'll be 60 years old. Soon I'll be 60 years old, and I wanna know if I will be successful and not be struggling. Soon I'll be 60 years old. Old, my mama told me to be the nicest girl that I could ever be. Once I was 7 years old. Once I was 7 years old. she broke your throne, she cut your hair, and from your lips she drew the hallelujah. Hallelujah, 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 hallelujah. Maybe I've been here before, I've seen this room, I've walked this door, I used to live alone before I knew you. I saw your flag on its marble arch, and love is not a victory march, it's a covenant, it's a broken hallelujah. Hallelujah, 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 hallelujah.
Mother Teresa blessed me, so
I don't know what else to say. Bless my God.
Thank you.
Jesus, you're my hope and stay. And when I cannot stand, I will fall on you. Jesus, you're my hope and stay.
One more time, it means about 5 million more times. So let's plan on that. The second one is, if you can hit your music baton directly on the music stand upwards, you can fling it into the back row of the clarinet or trumpet section. She's wonderful at that. She always makes the class laugh. And the third one is, she always said to us that if a boy ever sings to you, that you never let him go. So that's a lesson I've learned since like first grade. And so she has taught us so much, and she has been such an inspiration, and she's been there all my life for me, and she showed me that music is amazing and it can be wonderful, and I'd like to thank her on behalf of everyone. So.
With kids like this, and I've had so many talented kids over the years, those things make my job easy. But you're right, one more time does not ever mean one more time. And I tried to kill the flute players just the other day with my baton. So many of you have experienced that over the years. But thank you. Thank you so much for coming tonight, and enjoy the art. And please, I want to thank you from the bottom of my heart for supporting the arts in our school. They're very important. I'm a little concerned about our government, and I don't want to get political, but please, please support the arts. Do anything you can to keep funding for the arts, because I believe it's very important. One person told me that Bill Gates only wanted to hire artists and musicians, not just computer programmers, because those are the people that have imaginations. So I don't know if that's true, but someone once told me that. So thank you for coming tonight.
Before everybody goes, can I get the show choir and the choir people to come up here? If you guys are still here. I need the show choir and the choir people to come up here, if you're still here. Everybody. this year we got lucky with a pretty good amount of kids in choir and in show choir. And Miss Mingus, if you could come out here too. Well, I don't know if you guys know, but this is her last year here with us. Where's she at? And since last year and this year, it's kind of been a up and down. You know, we have our little moments, and especially in show choir. But I just want to thank her so much for what she has done, and I wish she would have stayed here for my 4 years.
I'll be around.
But she...
She's not leaving.
But we all would like to give her a big round of applause. Because she this year, for choir and show choir, we're hoping to get a one. So if you guys could come watch us at District Music, Music and Gibbon this year.
April 21st.
We'd enjoy that.
During the day. And then we have our concert May 1st.
Thank you for coming. Thank you.